I should put the microphone on. Sorry. No. Oh, it is done? I don't know. Because I have that. Oh, okay. Great. I still need to put it somewhere. This too.
Maybe to the top.
Now it's gone. I'm sorry. Okay, thank you. Great. All right, so let me first take a couple of minutes to explain what I'm going to do. So I will actually take an approach almost opposite to that of Clements. I will try to be broad. I will try to cover many things. And of course, if I have to be broad, I will necessarily be shallow. So I will not have really time to go to long derivations. I think on a couple of occasions I will try to sketch the ideas of the derivations, but I will not have time to complete them. I will mainly be staying with the slides, only occasionally going to the blackboard. And my idea is that, I mean, if you see something which you think is cool, that's in the literature. Just go find the literature. I will help you by providing some references. Everything is available, just read it and see that it's indeed cool. Right, I will have some overlap with other lecturers. We didn't coordinate really. So I will have, definitely I will have overlap with Clements. I will have overlap with John Tufel, which I will only figure out after his first lecture, and then my second lecture is immediately after him. So I will not even have time to adjust. I will have overlap with Mark Dickman and probably less with other lecturers. Which is also fine, because if you see the same thing explained by different people, it usually helps. Now, what else? So I will try to explain things, and as I said, I will show you probably a lot of things, but my lectures are not about priorities. I mean, there will be experts in the audience for some of the topics. So if you see, I will probably be heavily skewed towards Delft results, just because it's easier for me just to take pictures from my colleagues than to cut them out from the papers. If you see that the time I'm doing something and something needs to be added, please add it. Just feel free to interrupt me. Feel free to ask questions, and of course I will be also available after the lecture and during the workshop hours. Now I will give three lectures. One today will be about nanomechanics. One more will be also today, the last one, that will be about microwave optomechanics. And the main idea of that lecture will be to show you that you can do the same things with microwaves, which you can do with optics, with real optomechanics. And then I will have one more lecture on Thursday, which will also be on microwave optomechanics, but there I will concentrate on the differences, on nonlinear effects, and that will be close to my own research. There will be something else. All right, now let me go through that one. So I have like four themes. I will first go and explain what are mechanisms of coupling of mechanical resonators to everything else. Then I will go to something which I write here, detection. And what I mean by this detection is that often people don't particularly care about mechanical resonators, but they want to measure something. They want to measure some effect, and it's just easier to use mechanical resonators as a tool to measure this effect. I will give some examples, but let me give one now. I see Robin Doleman in the audience, and he is measuring thermal properties of graphene, which he has a poster, and he will be, I hope, happy to explain all of you what he is exactly doing. I'm not going to talk about that. But his focus is that's what he wants to measure, but the tools he is using are mechanical. And I will show some examples of the experiments with that idea. You don't learn so much about mechanical properties, but you use them as a tool to measure something you're interested in. Then I will spend some time explaining doublet lamp beams, and hopefully we will learn something about some things which are related to that. And then in the very end, I will talk about graphene in 2D materials, also concentrating, of course, on what is related to mechanical properties. Right, now we are at International Center for Theoretical Physics. I am a theorist. So let's start with an equation. And that's an equation which we have seen already today. You have actually seen it many times before. If everything is fine, you should have seen it at high school, and definitely, if not definitely, at the first year of the university. And that's something which we all very well know. Right? That's an equation for a single mode mechanical oscillator. So we have inertia, we have friction. I've written it so that this friction coefficient is the frequency divided by the quality factor. And this is just the return force of the pendulum. So that's a linear oscillator. So this return force is linear. And that's a driven harmonic oscillator. I've written here, so the mass goes to the denominator. Otherwise, it would be in all these three coefficients here. And here I've written the harmonic force which drives this oscillator. And again, that's something which we very well know. We know how to solve that equation, and we know what happens. Right? We know that the solution would be the motion of this oscillator with the frequency which is equal to the frequency of the driving force. And there could be some phase involved, and the amplitude is strongly dependent on the frequency with which you drive the oscillator. Right? So it depends something like that. That's supposed to be a Lorentzian. I excuse for my drawing skills, and actually I will have, you know, you will have more examples later on in this and other lectures that I cannot really draw. So I just apologize now for all of those examples. So that's supposed to be a Lorentzian, and we know that the highest amplitude is actually if you drive it at resonance. So if this frequency equals to the eigenfrequency of the oscillator. And we also know that the amplitude and the width of this Lorentzian are determined by the quality factor. Right? That's something which I hope we kind of commonly share this knowledge. So I don't need to go into details and explain. Now, what is nanomechanics and optomechanics as a part of nanomechanics about? Well, from the theoretical framework, it's about solving similar equations, but more complicated, right? Now, if you only care about properties of this oscillator. I'm sorry, that should not be harmonic. It should be more advanced oscillator, mechanical oscillator. It's not harmonic, what is here. Now, you start adding some details. Well, I mean, you add some force which is nonlinear, that's why it's not harmonic. Your quality factor may start depending on the position. Your driving force may depend on the position. And then you start solving those complicated equations. And that's actually a large part of what many of us are doing. You just know that there is something going on. I mean, you had parametric driving here, you had Duffington's here, and you see what happens and what are the properties of this resonator. I think actually I anticipate that what Mark Dickman will be talking about is, at large part, is about that. It's about how can you solve very complicated situations which arise when you start adding these crazy things to the equation. Now, okay, as I said, that's a theoretical approach. Now, of course, you also have another part which is maybe more interesting, is how do you arrive to that equation? How do you know which equation you need to solve? Right? Because solving equations is, well, mathematics. Right? I mean, you still need to make some approximations, and then because we are making those approximations, mathematics becomes physics, but it's much more physics in how you actually write and derive those equations. So you basically need to start with a real system, which you're interested in, and see what this system is doing, and what do you need to add to describe the system and what equation would be describing it. And that's for me at least much more fun than just solving the equation, which you get from somewhere. And we will be also talking about that. Now, it's usually not enough just to look at the oscillator. Usually things are much more complicated. Usually you don't just have an oscillator, it's coupled to something. And this something also has its own dynamics. And this something here in this equation, I added y here. And this y also has this equation of motion. It has its own evolution, which you also need to consider. And then they are coupled, and then things really become complicated. And we have just heard in the lecture of Clemens an example of those. So we had an equation for the oscillator, which in his case was simple harmonic oscillator. But also, this oscillator is coupled to the field, and the field has its own dynamics, and we had just half an hour ago equations for these dynamics on the blackboard, and coupling we didn't even consider yet, so that will be coming on the next lecture. So in this case, you need to solve simultaneously an equation for the mechanical oscillator and the equation for the fields, and they are coupled, and we will see they are coupled actually non-linearly, and the field is quantum, and the oscillator is sometimes quantum. So things the degree of complexity can actually increase infinitely, and it's also nice. Right? Now, okay, as I said, the theoretical framework. Let's see it at more specific examples. And in real life, I mean, of course, mechanical resonators could be coupled to anything. In real life, at least in real life, which we kind of all are part of, they are typically coupled to five different things. So they're coupled to charge, and the main mechanism is capacitive coupling. Now I'm just giving names. I will go immediately explaining what it means. They are coupled to electromagnetic radiation, and the main mechanism is radiation pressure coupling. They are coupled to spin, and I have actually no idea whether there is any name for this mechanism. I put it blank. They coupled to flux or magnetic flux, and that's inductive coupling. But actually, well, I mean, from our everyday experience, we know that the easiest thing you can couple a mechanical resonator is another mechanical resonator. Right? We have a lot of things which are described like coupled pendulum. Now, it actually turns out that if we go to the nanovolt, to nanomechanics, things become more complicated, and it's more difficult to couple them. And I will now have eight slides about that. I don't have slides explaining coupling between mechanical resonators, but I will later on, I will show you an experiment where this coupling is important, and we will see what is interesting about it. Okay, now let's, oops, Something is going on, I think. Okay. Looks like my battery is dying, so I will probably use that one if it, oops, no. Okay, that's what I wanted. Yeah, I think I have that one here. So, for every mechanism I'm going to discuss, I will give just one theoretical picture and hopefully an explanation. And then I will show you an actual experiment which uses that. Without, as I said, without going into much details. And so I think this one should be fine. If they're compatible, which I'm not even sure.
This is very theoretical approach.
Okay, great, thank you. Seems to be fine. Yeah, great, thanks. So let's start from the explanation. It's capacitive because we are talking about a capacitor, right? So a capacitor is something where you have charge and you apply voltage and charge is proportional to the voltage. I see that I have some formulas missing on my slide. So you have Q equals to C V. C is capacitance and you can write the energy, which is the simplest case would be Q squared over 2C. Now, imagine that one of the plates is mechanically moving. And then if one of the plates is mechanically moving, then this capacitance would be a function of the position of the plate. Now, it's actually much worse. Because imagine we don't have to assume it's moving, but let's say one of the plates is somehow deformed. Now, it's like on my picture, that's supposed, it doesn't really matter what you do, but here we have three electrodes, so we have left and right, and you have one plate which is sitting between them, and another plate is a gate. And usually you just apply voltage to the gate and see what happens with the transport from left to right. It's not really important for my story right now, it will be important later. But what is important that if this plate has a non-trivial shape, then your capacitance depends on this shape, and not just on one coordinate, but on the displace, on the deviation from the horizontal at every point. And that's a big deal, right? That the displacement becomes a field, and then you need to treat this field and whatever. Now, what people usually do, that's already, Clemens already mentioned, people usually assume that it's not just an arbitrary displacement, but you go to the normal modes, you go to the description of the mechanical oscillator in terms of normal modes, and you just select one mode, which in this case, I have selected, those modes are, let's say if these two ends are fixed, then this mode is just a sine, because sine is the only function which is harmonic and which is fixed at both ends. So different modes are just different sines, and this is the first mode, and the second mode would be doing something like that. And then maybe I should draw it. The first mode is this. The second mode would be that. The third mode would be this. But every mode is only characterized by one number. And this number is essentially the amplitude of the displacement. And if it's just one number, you can say, okay, we are just in one mode, so we have this capacitance which depends on only this one number. And for this number has its own dynamics. That's a harmonic oscillator. We can write this equation for harmonic oscillator for this Z, which yeah. And okay, fine. Now what we have is the energy of the capacitor, which now depends on the position of the harmonic oscillator. And that's coupling. And because by definition, coupling is if you have two systems, in our case it's capacitor and mechanical resonator. And that's a little bit semantics, because if you look at the picture, right, then the mechanical resonator is a part of the capacitor, but still one of them is electric and one of them is mechanic, and that's why we can separate them. We know that there is energy of electric system and energy of mechanical system. And if the total energy is the sum of the two, then they are non-interacting. Right? Does everybody follow? But now, if the total energy is not just the sum of the two, then they are interacting. And we can write the interaction explicitly. And I will have it later on the slides. But we can actually take this formula, so this q squared over 2c times 2c, that, and we can say, okay, maybe this z is very small, and typically it's very small. It's probably much less than the distance between the plates. And then the change of the capacitance is very small, and we can expand it. Right, and then we can say C is some C naught, whatever it means, which would be at Z equals 0, plus dC over dZ times Z. Right, and then we can put it over there, and then this Q squared over 2C of Z would be Q squared over 2C naught minus let's see if I can write it immediately correctly. 1 over 2 C squared, C naught squared, DC DZ times Z times Q squared. Now, the important thing here is that that's the interaction. So for this capacitive coupling, the interaction is just a product of mechanical coordinate times charge squared, or if you want, voltage squared. And I will explore that a little bit further in the lecture today in the evening. Now, I spent some time on that. Let me mention one thing which I will probably be mentioning by every coupling mechanism. Now, I said, okay, if we have interaction of mechanical resonators and charge, it's typically capacitive, but it's not always capacitive. You could also imagine other mechanisms which couple mechanical resonator and charge. And I just give here one example, for instance, piezoelectric coupling. I mean, a piezoelectric is a material where you can induce strain by adding, by applying voltage. And now if you induce strain, it means you also have mechanical displacements inside the material. You have some rearrangement of some parts of the material which cause strain. And if you can use it for any nano-mechanical experiment, it's not easy because those displacements are happening in some bulk system. But if you can use them, then you will have piezoelectric coupling of charge and mechanical resonator. That's not the mainstream, but people are using that. Right. I have chosen a random picture which illustrates this experimental picture which illustrates the capacitive coupling. I will have more pictures later on because that coupling happens pretty often. That's an experiment of Mark Bokrot, who was at the time at UC Riverside. And that's about their group was studying graphene. And so what they do, they put a graphene flake over a hole. So they have holes and beyond the hole, there is a back gate. And this back gate is exactly what I put here. So you just put a voltage, and by voltage, you can deform the graphene. And they could study it. And that's exactly their capacity. Coupling, they could also put the, some time-dependent signal, but I will not go into the details. Right. Next one is interaction with light. I will be very brief because Clemens will spend some time on that in his next lecture. So that's an optomechanical cavity. We have seen that there is, if you just take a single mode of light, then there is a cavity frequency which is well-defined. And now, if, well, the frequency, the cavity is two mirrors, and if one mirror is moving, then the cavity is modulated. Because the frequency is determined by the distance between the mirrors. So you can say, okay, if there is a mechanical motion of one of the mirrors, then the cavity frequency depends on the position, and similarly to that story, I can actually expand it. This displacement is very small. I can always expand it. And if I expand it, I take this Hamiltonian, which we had, and Clemens had it already, so h bar times the cavity frequency times the number of photons. And from this expansion, I will get the radiation pressure term, which is proportional to the number of photons times the displacement. And that's radiation pressure coupling. Now, what I want to mention is that actually, again, that's clearly the mainstream mechanism of interaction of light and mechanical resonator, but that's not the only mechanism. You can, for instance, think about optical phonons in solids interacting with light, and they have completely different mechanism because they're that dipole moment which they create interacts with electric field. That's not, people are not using that, it's not convenient, it's difficult to make cavities, but it's something which in principle provides you with an alternative mechanism. And experiments here, that one I've picked from my colleagues in Delft, the Simon Groblacher's group. Now I will maybe spend, Simon will be here next week, possibly talking about this experiment, I'm not sure. Maybe I will spend half a minute explaining what you see. Because, well, cavity is two mirrors and you expect to see two mirrors. But here there are no mirrors. Here there are those strange things which look like black and white and which contain some strange inclusions. Right, those things are actually parts of photonic crystal. So those are basically you take something and you drill holes. Now, why drilling holes is a mirror? I mean, that's something which I maybe spent a bit of time. I mean, one thing which most of us know from basic solid-state physics, or you can also know it from basic optics, that if you have a lattice, a perfect lattice, and you send a wave into this perfect lattice, there is no scattering. Right? That's something which is normally taught in solid-state physics. It's not necessarily emphasized, but it's kind of always implicit. Right? In solid-state physics, you need impurities to have scattering. If you have no impurities, you don't have scattering. Everything goes through. So if you just take this thing and drill holes which are all the same at the same distance, that's a crystal, and it would never scatter light, and it will also never scatter sound. Right? You can send light along the crystal. You can send sound waves along the crystal. If the crystal is perfect, they will never be scattered. So if you want to make scattering, you need to take those holes different. And then they can actually do it in some clever way so that the different holes act a little bit like those two mirrors. They act like a cavity. And this cavity is also, at the same time, cavity for light and cavity for sound, for phonons. And in this way, they actually make this, they enhance interaction between light and phonons. And I will not go into any other details, even though I will show you the result of this experiment later in the evening. Right. Now, coupling to spin. There are different mechanisms. the mainstream mechanism is here, so that's actually the cartoon taken from the experiment of Dan Ruger at IBM 13 years ago. The idea is that if you just take two magnets, they exert mechanical force on each other. All right, so what you can do, you can just take a cantilever, you can put one magnet to a cantilever, and you can use this cantilever for sensing of a different magnet somewhere around. So if there is a magnet somewhere in the substance, some magnetic moment, you can use this cantilever with a magnetic tip to sense this magnet. And actually it was demonstrated in that very experiment, and then you can actually, in this way, you can see a single electron spin. The sensitivity is so high, you can see just a single spin. And that was actually later on, but as I said, it's quite some time ago, it was later on developed in the separate field, which is called magnetic resonance force microscopy. Now, the next picture would be a picture of an experiment, that it's notoriously difficult to find a good picture of a spin detection experiment, probably because they're very boring. Because, well, basically you need a cantilever with something in the end. That's one of the best pictures I have, so that's from the group of Olivier Arcizet in Grenoble. They used this tip with, in the end, you see this shining point, which is increased here, doesn't help much, but okay, that's the same. And that's an NV center. Now, I guess probably some of you must have heard about NV centers, that if you take diamond, then sometimes there are natural defects, so you can also induce those defects if you want, where instead of a carbon atom, you have, well, diamond is pure carbon, but you can sometimes replace carbon with a nitrogen. And then next to the nitrogen, there is a vacancy. And for whatever reason, those complexes, so those defects, are they have spin one itself, and they are they use as very good sensors. So this sensing something with the NV with an NV center is becoming a mainstream, and there will be more and more and more groups coming. Now I will not be talking about spin anymore. In my lectures, and I don't expect, to be honest, other lecturers to talk about that. So for spin, I will give a credit, and I will add one more slide. And by the way, I think tomorrow at 2, we will have a symposium, or whatever it's called, by Robert Schacht and Daniel Gorelick in the main building of ICTP, talking about nano-mechanical spintronics. So that's related to the things I mentioned. Okay, so I prepared another one. Again, there is no good picture of the experimental device, but there is a good picture of explaining what they're doing. That's the experiment of the group of Patrick Malitinsky in Basel. They also use NV centers. And NV centers have another property. The energy structure of an NV center is strongly sensitive to the strain. So if you deform diamond, that would change the electronic structure. And actually what they have done, they managed to put an NV center in some piezo substrate. They put it on a cantilever driven by a piezo substrate. And because of that, they were able to drive the NV center itself. And this is the coherent drive of an NV center, which is oscillating between the probability of occupation of one of the states. Right. Now, inductive coupling, I will actually spend quite some time on my last lecture on Thursday, so I will skip discussion of it now. Let me just mention that inductive coupling is about inductance, and inductance is the proportionality coefficient between flux and current, and if you take a time derivative of that, time derivative of flux is minus voltage, so you will get you will get voltages, inductance times I dot, and then you can also write the energy, which is inductance times current squared over 2, and in some situations, which I explained on Thursday, inductance could be position dependent, and then you can similarly to capacitive coupling, you also get inductive coupling, where would be also not surprisingly in the same way x times I squared. Okay, now as I said, let me go to those things. Let me give you some example where people could use mechanical resonators to measure things which were difficult to measure before that. And let me start with the example of the experiment of Jack Harris. I will show the experiment on the next, well, in two slides, I think. But let me first explain what the experiment is about. The experiment is about measuring persistent currents. And persistent currents is a big deal, so it was a big deal in the 90s. So the idea is, imagine you have a metallic ring and there is some flux going through the ring, so perpendicular. Now, if you have flux, you will induce current in the ring even if there are no contacts. Right, usually we think, okay, if you have some conductor, then if the conductor is equilibrium, there is no current. But if you put voltage, then there is current. Now here there is no voltage, but there is flux, which actually still induces current. And to understand that, let's very briefly go through the sketch. So you just take an electron, which is sitting in the ring, and the Hamiltonian of this electron is just p squared over 2m. But since there is magnetic field, this p is not p, but the so-called long momentum. So you need to add the vector potential. Now, if that's general, now since they're sitting on the ring and only move in one direction, then the only relevant variable, the only relevant coordinate is the phase along this ring. I can just write everything, project on a phase, so then I will get the derivative of this phase, which is just momentum, and I get flux divided by flux quantum, which I, for whatever reason, didn't write here. The flux quantum is just this combination of fundamental constants. So this is speed of light, and this is charge of electron. And now I can say, fine, we have this Hamiltonian. Obviously, the motion has to be periodic. So the because it's periodic, the wave functions can only be like that, right? So it would be e to the e times some integer times this phi. And we can ask, okay, fine, what are the energies of such a Hamiltonian with such functions? That's trivial to calculate, same way you are calculating whatever levels of a single, of a one-dimensional infinite square well. You can just do it, and then this is the result you get. So it depends on flux, it depends on this n. You can say that at a given, so at every given n, as a function of flux, the energy is a parabola, which is drawn here. So that's for different values. Those parabolas are for different values of the flux. And then, let's say for every given flux, the ground state is whichever parabola is the lowest. So the system adjusts its number n to the flux. So you just take the n which is closest to phi over phi naught, And then you're in the ground state. Okay, but that's not so much important. What is important is actually that the energy depends on the flux. The energy of the ground state in particular, of any state, depends on the magnetic field. And if the energy depends on the magnetic field, then there is a current. And then we get current in the ground state. And okay, that was this. You can also go on and estimate the amplitude of the current. How strong would it be? And unsurprisingly, it's actually not strong. It's very weak. It's very difficult to measure. And then if you start going into details, that's actually why it was a big deal. You can, for instance, easily do it for just a single ring, but for a single ring it's difficult to measure because the signal is too weak. You can also go to disordered rings and look at ensembles of rings. You can take many rings and see what would be the average current. And then there are many interesting things. For instance, there is a difference between if you calculate it in canonical and grand canonical ensemble, and that's actually why it became one of the main most important things in mesoscopic physics, which I will skip for the time being. What is important and what actually, that's the quote from this paper of Jack Harris's group, is that there were a lot of theoretical results, there were some experimental results, and they didn't match very well. So there was some controversy, which at some point people gave up, stopped measuring, and it remained unresolved for whatever, 15 years or something. And now this paper came, so it's 2009. What they did, they put those rings, which are here, on a cantilever. Actually, that's a sketch. The real structure is here. So you see there are just rings and rings and rings and rings around. That's many of them, because you want to enhance the signal. Now, what happens is that you put them in the magnetic field, and magnetic field produces this persistent current, and the persistent current actually produces torque and shift the frequency of the cantilever. And you can measure this frequency shift. And actually, the frequency is the quantity you can measure with the highest precision. Of everything, of all measurements which are around, the most precise measurement is the measurement of frequency. And they measured the frequency, and then everything was fine with the theory. There is maybe one more thing I want to emphasize before I go to the next experiment. I think most of you are theorists, but there are some experimentalists around. Just look at the list of authors. So they have three theorists on the paper. So Leo Glasman is a senior person who just moved to Yale, I believe, at that point. Felix von Oppen is a senior person, his collaborator. And Aaron Ginesser, I think he was a postdoc at the time. So you basically need three theorists on experimental paper to make it into science. Think about it. All right. That's a different story. That's an experiment of Eva Weick when she was still in Munich, 2013. She will be coming maybe even during my lecture here today. What they looked at, two coupled oscillators. So I said, okay, we can easily couple oscillators. Well, maybe not easily. And this is one example. Now there are oscillators. Okay, if you think about couple oscillators, we think about coupled pendula, right? We have like two pendula and then tie them maybe and see what they're doing. Now in their case, it's not at all like that. In their case, they have this some complicated structure. And they, when they talk about coupled oscillators, they talk about actually two different modes, two different normal modes. And one of the mode is in plane motion, and another mode is out of plane motion. So those are just two different modes, which are coupled because of some properties of this material. And now what they were interested in, they were interested in coherent manipulation of those modes. So they have, for instance, they could drive, they have a control parameter, which is gate voltage. So it's again about capacitive coupling. And with the gate voltage, they could drive to start with those two modes. And they see that at some point they become very close to each other. And if they become very close to each other, well, I mean, you can populate the lowest mode and the highest mode and see what it does. So you can just look at this mode, and the power is the amplitude of the motion, essentially. You can look at that mode and see what this mode does. And you can actually see that if you drive it in a smart way, then the power goes from one mode to another mode and oscillates between the modes, which is very similar to what people do in qubits, right? You have two states, you populate one state, and then you have Rabi oscillation between the states. And actually, they made this analogy even further. They looked at the Bloch sphere, because the qubit is essentially spin 1/2, and for spin 1/2, you can put all the states of the spin 1/2 on this Bloch sphere and see what it's doing. I will not go into details, but that's a really cool experiment, which shows that you can do a lot coherently with mechanical systems. Now, to finish that part, let me talk about mass detection. The idea of mass detection is actually very easy, and that was developed for many years in the lab of Michael Rukes on Caltech. The idea is that you take some mechanical element. It could be a double beam. It could be a cantilever. I will show it. And you just put it into some medium. And then there are some molecules coming. And then molecules stick to this beam. And if the molecules stick, then the mass increases. And if the mass increases, the frequency goes down. And as I said, the frequency measurement is the most sensitive measurement you have around. So you can just, by measuring frequency, you can measure mass. You can say, okay, well, that's a massive system, right? It's nano, but it's still a big piece of some material. I actually don't know which material they're using. It contains zillions of atoms. What if you just add one molecule? Why should it change anything? Well, okay, depends, of course, what is your sensitivity and what molecule you are adding. So this is the experiment of 2006, and they had a sensitivity of 100 zeptograms, which is 10 to the minus, what is it, zepto? 21, right? Yeah. 10 to the minus 21. Just to give a perspective for the LIGO measurements, which Clemens showed, the expected sensitivity was zip to meters, so 10 to the 21 meters, and they didn't reach it because they were lucky with this supernova explosion. So they could go a little bit higher. Right now, zeptograms have been achieved 10 years ago. What they do, that basically time, it means they just open this shutter and nozzle, and they start adding molecules. And they just see what happens. And the frequency goes down. And actually, it goes down in almost in steps. And each step corresponds to the zeptogram sensitivity. Now they actually, the same group, that's 2012 experiment, they have done it with a different device. They claim they achieved a single molecule sensitivity. Now, of course, it's not a hydrogen molecule. It's something like a protein, so which is still pretty heavy. That was roughly same time, the experiment of the group of Adrian Bachtold in ICFO, and they claimed yoctogram sensitivity. Yocto is 24, I think. But they used carbon nanotubes, and that has certain limitations. But okay, that's how you can just, I mean, that. And I think it's still improving. So that's the way how you can do things. And okay, now, as I said, so in those experiments, you particularly don't care about mechanics. You just use mechanics as a tool to do something. I mean, here you can measure frequency very well. You just see what happens with the frequency, and you just deduce something which is completely mechanics unrelated. You can use it as a sensor of whatever concentration of some substance, which whatever. Right. Now, these two two doubly clamped beam part, I will organize it in this way. So that's one particular experiment by the group of Shahalalani, which I must admit I learned earlier this year about the existence of this experiment from Fabio, and he is actually the person who probably have done the most in this direction. But I will only go through very simple things. So let me first explain what the experiment is, what they actually measure, what they see, and then we'll spend some time understanding what they have seen. All right, so what they use and by the way, there are also two highly qualified theorists on this paper. What they use is a carbon nanotube, which you can hardly see here. They helped us, but I'm not sure. I mean, I can see it, but probably those of you who are sitting on the back cannot. This carbon nanotube is suspended between source and drain, which means you send current from source to drain through this carbon nanotube. Now, carbon nanotubes could be metallic or insulating, and in this case, it's irrelevant for the reasons I will explain in a moment. Now, on top of that, they have gates. This 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, those are gates. They are lying below. And what you can do, you can selectively put voltage on one of the gates. You can also put on several, but that would make things more complicated. So let's say one. And by putting voltage on one of the gates, you can actually deform this nanotube. So you can, for instance, because of this capacitive coupling which I outlined of. So for instance, if you put voltage on the gate one, then this part of the nanotube gets attracted to gate one. So you will get something which is here it's more straight and here it's more deformed. And for instance, if you put it on gate three, which is in the middle, then it's something which would have something like this picture which I showed you before, which has closest parties to the gate three. Okay, now on that, they measure current as a function of this gate voltage. Well, it is shown for two different gates. This is gate three, this is gate four, but they have it for all gates. Oh yeah, here I should, okay, never mind. And what they see, there are two important developments. One development is that the frequency goes up with the gate voltage. And second is that on top of this monotonic dependence, you also see this strange minima. So sometimes it stops going up, goes down, then goes up again, but on average it goes up. And these are two things which we need to understand. Right, so that the picture which I already shown you, and actually it's that the picture which we specifically I've taken from one of my very old presentations, because we were looking at carbon nanotubes. So now we can think that this line is a carbon nanotube. And if this carbon nanotube is deformed, it becomes like that, and that modifies the capacitance. Also, I should mention that that's, of course, not the first experiment with carbon nanotubes around. That's another one from Delft by Gary Steele when he was still a postdoc. He suspended the carbon nanotube between those two electrodes, and the gate is just underneath. So it's a very similar idea, but he just had one gate and whatever. Now here I put some scales and I screwed something up. But anyway, so the size, so you see it's 400 nanometers, so the length of this carbon nanotube is 500 nanometers. And the frequencies in his case was 140 megahertz. I think in Shahalalani's experiment, the frequency is around, well, here it starts at 200 and here it starts at 80. Depends exactly what you are doing with the nanotube, but in any case, it's in the range of 100 of megahertz. Okay, let's first understand why the frequency goes up. Well, very roughly speaking, and kind of on an intuitive level, if you apply voltage to the gate, you just pull the nanotube. Right? That's what capacitive coupling is about. That's still on the blackboard behind me. If you, well, here could be, let me just add it so we have it. That's proportional to the displacement times voltage squared. So that basically means if you apply voltage, you pull it mechanically, right? You have a mechanical force. On the nanotube, you just pull it. Now, from everyday's life, you know if you pull something, if you just pull it like that or like that, if I play a guitar, I increase the frequency. And that's exactly why the frequency is increased. There is nothing special about nano, except for that it's probably easier to pull it by gate than by pull it by whatever, by hand. But there is nothing really special here. So that just the frequency goes up because you pull it by the gate. And because it's V squared, it doesn't matter whether you put positive voltage or negative voltage, whatever you do, you pull. Here it's actually it's a bit more complicated, but let's go through the detail. So again, this is an equation which I had on my first slide. So okay, the nanotube in the first approximation is a harmonic oscillator. So it has inertia, it has friction, it has this return force. Now we don't drive it by itself. We don't apply any harmonic force, which I had in my equation. But what happens, we pull it by the gate. And there is this force coming from the gate. And we just need to calculate this force. It's not trivial. I'm not going to do it. It's some non-trivial electrodynamics. I will just show you the result. The result is essentially that. So this is the energy, and the force is the derivative of the energy over the coordinate. Right? So the force which we get here would be proportional. I don't actually know what this 1/2 is. Oh, 1/2 is coming probably because it just divided by 2. Anyway, so there would be derivative of the capacitance. And here that would be normally just voltage squared. But also because we have a gate, it's not voltage squared, it's voltage minus gate voltage squared. And the voltage on the nanotube itself, that's something which you would need to calculate. You just solve this simple electrostatic problem, like you have this nanotube, there is a capacitance to the gate, capacitance to the source, capacitance to the drain. You just write all those whatever energy differences, and then this is what you come with. Now, what is important that this, first of all, that this force is still dependent on the coordinate. I mean, you can, of course, approximate it by this and this by linear relations, but then we don't get any interesting effects. But if you go beyond linear relations, if you take capacitance which is more than x dependent, which is x squared, and if you take that which is x squared, then we still have force which is dependent on x. And now what we do, we can first of all expand this force. There will be terms which are proportional to the x, to the displacement, terms proportional to x squared, terms proportional to x cubed. And you see here, if you have on the right-hand side, we have terms proportional to x, they would renormalize the frequency of our resonator. Right? Because we just add that, and then we will get a new frequency squared. And that's exactly why the frequency is changed on the level of equations. And now, to mention that, that also if we take these terms into account, then our resonator, which is by itself was a harmonic oscillator, it becomes a non-linear oscillator. And it could show all kinds of things which non-linear oscillators show. And I will not be talking about that now, but I will return to that in my lecture 3, when I will be talking about non-linear things. Right, so that so far we understood why it goes up. We still don't understand this minima. The minima are not, or at least not trivially, in this expression. We need to understand something more to understand the minima, and there's something more is called Coulomb locate. And Coulomb locate is, let me first start with the intuitive explanation, what is it? So imagine you have some very small object, and this object has, which is a part of electric circuit, and this object has a very small capacitance. Now, if the capacitance is very small, then this energy Q squared over 2C is very large. Now, imagine I want to transport charge through this object. Now, I just put it here, so I put a source and I put a drain and I put voltage between source and drain. And now to transport charge, I need first to put electron into that object and then take it from the object, right? But if I want to add it to the object, I have to pay a lot of energy because this electrostatic energy is very large. And this energy must be coming from somewhere. So it's either should be provided by temperature. Temperature should be high enough. So temperature should be, KBT should be higher than that. Or I usually, because if you want to see something interesting, you want KBT less than that. Otherwise, if I want to overcome that, I need to apply voltage which is very strong, which is very high. That would overcome this electrostatic energy. And if my voltage is not high enough to overcome this electrostatic energy, then there is just no transport. And that's called Coulomb locate. People started to study it actually in quantum dots, but right now, for instance, it's more, much more common to have experiments on single molecules and whatever, which can also serve as conductors. Now, let's go into some details, which again, I will not provide too much. If you want to know more, go and read it in the literature. Basically, I didn't say that, but I will say that now. The reason why we have Coulomb locate is that because electron charge is quantized, right? You cannot have half electron charge. You can only have 0, 1, or 2, or 70. But you can't have 1, half, or 3 quarters. And that's exactly why you need, if you put an electron, you put the whole electron. That's why you have E squared over 2C. And you cannot have less than E squared over 2C, because that would mean you will have less electron charge, than less charge than the electron charge. Right? Now, I can say, fine, let's say we have some state where we have n electrons here, and some state with n plus 1. We could have, for instance, n equals 0 and n plus 1 equals 1. Doesn't matter. And now, if those energies of the states of n and n plus 1 are drawn like that, then we should have no transport at zero temperature. Because if you want to have transport, we must have an electron from here from the left, which is somewhere in occupied states, going here. So electrons from occupied states can only go to this level, but not to that level, because they should do it at the same energy. But then the electron also should be able to go to the right. And if it wants to go to the right, we should have an empty state to the right at this energy. Right, so we would only have transport if we have a state here. But we don't have a state here. We have one state which is against occupied levels left and right, and one state which is against empty levels left and right. So if we have in this situation, we are in the Coulomb location. We can formalize that by just calculating. Also, so those are the conditions. You have one level should be bigger than both voltages left and right, and here I put the right voltage zero, doesn't matter. And another one should be below those two, and of course there are four conditions, and one is redundant, because I assume that this one is bigger than that one, but it doesn't have to be like that. Could be Sn bigger than Sn plus one. You can actually calculate those energies, and those energies, I'm not going to do that, but what is important, the source energies are always linear functions of the voltages on the left and on the right, and on the gate. And so if you just start plotting that, usually people plot it like this, so you have the gate voltage here, and you have bias, which is a difference here, left minus right, then there are these structures which are called Coulomb diamonds. And within every diamond, so like here, the number of electrons is fixed. Like for instance, in this one, the number of electrons is zero. This one is one, and this one is minus one, here it's two, and so on. And if the number of electrons is fixed, it means you have Coulomb blockade, because if you want to have transport, you need to be able to change the number of electrons. You need to add one electron here, and then from zero it would become one, and then you would remove it to the right, and then it would become zero again. And that's not possible if you are sitting inside the diamond, but that's possible outside the diamonds, here and here. And you can actually take this into account, because that's all in this formula. You can take this into account, and you can calculate the force and the frequency shift, which I'm not going to do. Oops, sorry. And in the frequency shift, you have a term which is actually proportional. It goes with minus, and it's proportional to the derivative of the average number of electrons over the gate voltage. And now I apologize for this drawing. I mean, for whatever reason, every time I put a background and then restart my PowerPoint, the background disappears. I don't know why. So we have to look at it like that. You see, this picture shows this average number of electrons, and that's an exact derivative of that picture, because, for instance, if you take bias equals zero and you go along this line, then you see that it's zero, and then it's suddenly one, and then it's suddenly two, and so on. So it just can be only an integer number, and then between those numbers, it changes in steps. Right, and now if you take a finite bias, then those steps disappear and then become kind of smooth connection between the plateaus. But in any case, you have plateaus, which, well, this is another example. The two plateaus are joined smoothly, and if you are somewhere between the plateaus, it means you are here. Okay, and now we know that if we just take this and take a derivative, then we exactly get those minima which they see, and they were able actually to feed them to the theoretical problems. Right, and this is the similar experiment in DELT, in the group of Gary Steele, where they had also carbon nanotubes That's also they could fit it to our experimental, the experiment to our theoretical curves. And you see here, when you're at low bias, you have one minimum, and then when you have at high bias, you have two minima, because then you are crossing this point. Now there is one more thing, and that's something I would like to spend some time. I mentioned that you renormalize because of this Coulomb blockade. You renormalize the frequency, but you also renormalize the quality factor. And Frequency, I kind of could hand-wavingly explain. Quality factor, I cannot. Well, I mean, you can, of course, say that because there is, I mean, always if you couple something to something else, if you couple mechanical resonator to something else, then mechanical damping is, this mechanical resonator loses energy, and if there is coupling to some other system, it can also lose energy via decaying through this other system, so the damping in this hand-waving explanation should always go up, which sometimes it fails, sometimes damping goes down. And this is something which is very well known, for instance, in quantum optics, and it's called the Purcell effect. And I should have mentioned this shift of the frequency is called optical spring effect. But to take it to the quantitative level, it's actually difficult. I will give you the formula, which has been derived by those two papers, which Fabio is in the audience and all other people are not. And I will, on the next slide, will sketch how this derivation, what step this derivation goes through. That will be probably hard, so if you cannot follow, just don't follow. I will come back to some more easy things. But before I go through that, let me show this is the same experimental paper by Gary Steele's group. They could also fit the quality factor, and they fit it with this expression, and which again here you see that there is the derivative of this average number of electrons, and the fits are again, then sometimes they have one and sometimes they have two minima for the same reason as the frequency. And the agreement is not fantastic, but at least you see the same tendencies. Now let me sketch the steps. As I said, that's probably difficult to follow. If you find it difficult, just don't follow and wait until the next slide. Right, so the tool in to describe this Coulomb blockade, which I so far avoided to explain, is the master equation. And the master equation operates with this object, which is a probability to find exactly n electrons. And in usual Coulomb blockade without any mechanics, this probability depends on the number of electrons, and it may depend on time. And you write an equation for its evolution in time. And this is the master equation. Now, if we also have mechanical resonator, then this probability also starts depending on position and velocity of this resonator. Or if you want position and momentum, it doesn't matter. And you have to write the equation for the whole thing. And this becomes, I'm not even sure that if I do that the master equation is a good name. I think probably it's already the Boltzmann equation, but that's semantics. And let me, because there is one thing which I don't have on the slides. So if you don't have mechanical resonator, the equation is, then it's just total derivative, dpn over dt is whatever I call it, the collision integral, and I will specify right now what is it. Now let's imagine, for instance, we only have two states, like 0 and 1. All right, then I can write dp naught over dt equals to what? Why should I have this probability to have 0 electrons in my system? Why could it change at all? Well, it's obviously the only reason why it could change is because electrons, there are not 0 electrons anymore, but there is 1 electron. It could be also minus 1 if I take this into account. Or maybe there is even 2. But the electrons go, in this language, they go from the state 0 to other states. How do we describe it? We say, okay, if for the case when there is only 0 and 1 and nothing else, then I say, well, there is some rate to go from 0 to 1. I write here P naught, and I put here minus. This rate is probability to go from 0 to 1 per unit time. So it makes sure that I have a correct dimensions. Now it should be proportional to P0, because the more electrons I have, the faster they disappear. And it's minus, because if they disappear, my probability goes down. Right? Now there is another process, and they can only go to 1, because I've only chosen that there are 2 states. If I choose more states, they will go to all different states, but it would be still proportional to P naught and go with minus. Right? Now there is an opposite process. Electrons can go from elsewhere to 0. In this case, they can only go from 1 to 0. So I will have another term in this equation. Which is now proportional to P1, and with plus, because if they come to 0, then it becomes more. The probability to get into 0 gets higher. Right, so that's usual master equation. I mean, I have written it for the case when there are only 2 states, but I can write it for more complicated cases, and that's basically what people do. Then you can solve it for, you will also need another one for P1, which is written in a similar way. You also make sure that the sum of all probabilities is 1, which for 2 states make problem very easy, because P1 plus P0 is 1. You can only look at one of them. I will not go into that. There is one more step which is needed. We still don't know what those rates physically are. And for those rates, we need to look at our actual system, which is, we have tunneling here, we have tunneling here. We don't have any tunneling here. It's a purely capacitive connection. So we have tunneling from the late, from the left to the tube, from the right to the tube, from the tube to the left and to the right. And then those will make up those 4 rates. Those 4 will make those 2 rates. Now in this case, because it also depends on the position of the resonator, I have to add additional terms. So I keep this one there. My rates now may depend on the position, but other than that, it's okay. And what I should have into account, take into account, that this total derivative now becomes partial derivative plus dpn over dx x dot plus dpn over dv v dot. And now I know that x dot is v, and that's here. And I know that v dot is just proportional to the external force. And this force is the return force of the oscillator, it's friction. And there is also this force which comes from electrostatics, which is proportional to n. So for 0, there will be no force. For 1, it will be force. And that's actually a stochastic force, because every time you tunnel, the electron sits there and generates a force. And so it's there when the electron is there, and it's not there when the electron is not there. And the tunneling process is stochastic. So this is actually a stochastic equation. And then there is some way of dealing with stochastic equations. You can, so this some of those terms are kind of random functions. You can say they kind of noise. You can take into account that's, I'm not going to go into any details, but you can rewrite this equation as the Fokker-Planck equation. And in this way, you see that those rates, the role of those rates here, they renormalize the quality factor, and they also create diffusion in the velocity space. That's, again, that's overcomplicated, but at least that provides an expression for this quality factor, which I put on the previous slide. Right, now we have 10 minutes, and I will now go to something completely different. So that's if you got completely lost in that part, you have another chance to understand what I'm going to talk about. Right, I will talk about graphene first. And as I said, well, okay, graphene is a two-dimensional layer of carbon, which a lot of people are using because it has excellent mechanical properties. Well, it actually has a lot of excellent properties. We know that there was a Nobel Prize given out for excellent electric, unusual electric properties. It also has excellent mechanical properties, and that's what makes it attractive. And it's used as a resonator in a lot of experiments, which many of those don't at all care what properties of graphene is. And I will not be talking about those. I will actually show you a couple later, not in this lecture. So for the time being, it's enough to know that that's an excellent membrane which you have a lot of control over. But what I want to show you are things which are where you actually engage with the properties of graphene itself. So what interesting could be done? What do you learn about graphene if you look at mechanical vibrations? And now that would be pure theory. I don't know any experiments on that. But the theory is nice, and let me spend 5 minutes going through it. So the idea is due to first Suzuri and Ando before graphene. Actually, I think they were doing it in carbon nanotubes, and then by Guinea, Katnelson, and Vosmediano, was that actually if you deform graphene, you of course create local deformation, and this deformation, electrons in graphene see as fictitious magnetic field, actually as fictitious vector potential. And there are some formulas you can, if you know what those deformations are, they're usually described as components of this deformation tensor or stress tensor, whatever. Then you know what you should add, what potential components you generate, and then you have those components, and then you have Dirac equation. You just add those vector potential as gauge fields in the Dirac equation, because electrons in graphene are described by Dirac equation. And then the simplest thing you can do is just see what happens. And then, for instance, you can have some fun by taking some shapes of deformation, and that's what we have done in this paper. You can have some fun looking at what actually what potentials those deformations would produce, and what effect would it have on the properties of graphene, because you have some funny time position dependent magnetic fields. It's not something you usually do in solids. You usually have in solids. Okay, so that's fun, but that's not what I wanted to talk about. What I wanted to talk is that. That's another paper, so it's Fogler, Pinay, and Nelson. So what they have done, said, okay, well, let's just take a graphene membrane, suspend it over the gate. Well, they didn't even have a gate, so just suspend it. And see, so that deforms it. Let's take the deformation, calculate those vector potentials, and plug it in the equation and see what they're doing. Now, you know, this is the Fermi surface of graphene. So the spectrum of graphene, do I have it on the picture? No. The spectrum of graphene has so-called Dirac points, and at every Dirac point, you have a linear dispersion. So if everything is exactly compensated, you don't have electron syngraphy, because you are exactly at the point when the concentration is zero. Now you add a little bit of electrons, then the electrons are staying in the K space, in the reciprocal space close to those Dirac points. And your Fermi surface is just that. The electrons are living here, and they are nowhere else. There are no electrons here and no electrons here. Now what they said was, well, since we know that there are this vector gauge fields, and those gauge fields are actually shifting the momentum, they would be, the role of those fields, they would be shifting the position of those Dirac points. And if they shift the position of the Dirac points, this shift is different depending on where you are. I mean, in this point, it would be the strongest probably, and in this point, it would be the weakest. But in any case, if the electron has to go from here to here to here all the way to get on the other side, it will have to go from, let me again draw it. At one point, for instance, it would be sitting here, but at the other point, the position of this cone shifted. And maybe if deformation is strong, at some point it shifted so much that it doesn't overlap with the original one anymore. They should be same size. And then they argued that if the shift is such that there are two points where they don't overlap. So like at one point in space, here for instance, the electron spectrum is that, and at another point in space, the electron spectrum is that, then there will be no transport at all. Because there is no K at which electrons can actually go through the whole material. They will always see a point where they cannot go anymore because there are no states. And then they said, okay, that should be a metal-insulated transition. So if this is correct, that has never experimentally been observed as far as I know, and there are some good reasons for that. But if it's correct, it would be very difficult to observe in any case. But if this is correct, you have metal-insulated transition induced by mechanical deformation, which is great. Now, what that actually this part of the gate is what is what my student Maria Medvedeva has done some time ago. We put a gate, and if you have a gate, then you have another effect. And this other effect is similar to what we have discussed for Coulomb blockade, for instance. There will be more electrons at this point than at this point, because the potential is lower. So you don't just shift that, you also increase the radius if you move along the membrane. And whether you will actually have, and where it shifted most, the radius is actually the biggest. And then you need to look at the details, whether you will still go through the metal-insulated transition or not. And our conclusion was that actually it depends on, you must have some residual stress. So this graphene sheet should be stressed from the very beginning. And you should have some, and here is the gate voltage. And I think our conclusion was that in this area, if you have very large stress and very small gate voltage, you still stay with the physics of metal insulated transition. And if this residual stress is insignificant, then you will, this charge distribution will always kill the transition. All right, so let me go. I think I have two slides more in like 2 minutes, so I will just finish on time. Now, again, most of you have probably heard that next to graphene, there are other two-dimensional materials, they're called van der Waals materials, which have similar properties, They can also be produced in monolayers, with one important exception. They are all semiconductors. Well, graphene is technically speaking also a semiconductor, but it's a zero band gap semiconductor. So for all practical purposes, it's a metal. But those things are real semiconductors. And that's a picture which I borrowed from the Delft experiment by Andreas Castellanos, who was at the time also a postdoc. That's molybdenum diselenide. It's one of this family of these materials, which is a semiconductor, 2D semiconductor. I think that's a monolayer, and that's a real microscopy picture. And you see that actually they cannot really fabricate really flat membranes. What they fabricate has these wrinkles. And these wrinkles, I mean, they probably look a bit exaggerated, but in these wrinkles, there is a lot of stress concentrated. And so you can actually, to start with those materials, you can see what happens if there is big stress. I mean, if you have stress or strain, which is of the order of several percents. Right, if you think about that, that's a lot. I mean, if you just take a crystal, just a usual crystal, regular, whatever, 3D crystal, and if you would be able to induce several percents of strain, this crystal would just disappear. It would have all kinds of problems, it would not survive. Now, of course, in practice, it just disappears much before because of other problems, but that's a different story. So you have some areas where you have a lot of strain, and you can actually see what happens. And the strain is so strong here that it actually affects electronic structure in significant way. I mean, I have given here an example when the strain affects electronic structure, but here it was because there is this Dirac point, and this structure is very sensitive. Here there is no Dirac point, it's just a real semiconductor with a large gap. It's like electron volt gap. And then this is a picture, for instance, they know how much this strain is on this side, how much the strain affects the gap. And you see here they have a lot of points, and it's difficult to conclude, but in any case it's something between 1 and 3%, the gap change. And on the left I sketch very briefly the way they actually know it. They know it from exciton recombination. So an exciton is a complex of an electron and a hole. So you basically excite that by shining light. So if you shine light, if you eliminate something, then you give energy, and this energy goes to electrons, so that create one electron and one hole. So one electron which is sitting in the valence band, and the hole sitting in the electron sitting in the conduction band, hole sitting in the valence band, and this energy should match the size of the gap to make it efficient. And now, if you just go to a different point, at this point, the gap would be different, and the energy of the exciton would be different. It's of course very difficult to propagate exciton from here to here because you need to conserve energy. So the energy must be going somewhere. It should probably go to photons or whatever. But if they do it, to phonons. But if the exciton can move here, and can here, they can recombinate, so the electron hole goes together and excite a photon, this photon would have a different frequency. And by measuring this different frequency, and there is some good argument why it should happen exactly at that point and not here, which I will skip, then this would be a different frequency, and from this frequency you can measure this change of the gap. Right. I think I'm over time. So and that's my last slide anyway. So I stop here, and.